Hello, I'm Audrey Brown, and today in Focus on Africa, President Macron is on a fence-mending mission to Morocco today. We'll hear why Rabat and Paris had been at loggerheads for the last few years. Staying in France, what's making young black and brown people with ties in Africa leave the country to return to the land their parents and grandparents left behind?
En France, on peut avoir l'impression d'avoir un plafond.
In France, sometimes it feels like there's a glass ceiling. Within the leadership, the managers, you find very little diversity, very, very little, if any at all. Obviously, Africa feels more like open arms to me.
Forcément, l'Afrique me tend les bras.
It's Monday, the 28th of October. First, we go to Mozambique. This was the scene in Maputo over the last few days. Anger, dissatisfaction, violence. That was all happening on the streets. The newest opposition party, Podemos, has taken those feelings to court, demanding a recount of election results. Its lawyers had 300 kilograms of documents alleging irregularities to back up their case. The ruling party, Frelimo, or the Front for the Liberation of Mozambique, to give it its full name, albeit in English rather than Portuguese, has been in power since 1975. It had led a liberation war against the Portuguese and won. Then it fought a further war against an internal party, Renamo, which had the backing of a then-hostile South Africa. It won that war too. Now the country is embroiled in an Islamist insurgency in the north, and this electoral challenge from newcomers, Podemos, led by Financio Mondlane, demanding a recount because they believe that the Frelimo candidate, Daniel Chapo, had lost. Mr. Mondlane's supporters blame the incumbent Frelimo for the country's economic and political problems.
This country must be ruled by Venancio Mondlane. No one has the right to come and give orders to the people. This is our country. It belongs to us. Where are we going to go?
We did not vote for these leeches. We did not vote for this man, Chapo. We are tired. Our fathers built their life on hard times so that we have a place to sleep. We are still here after 39, 40 years. With our sons still living in the same place as our fathers because of Frelimo.
Heat on the streets of Mozambique's capital, Maputo. Fernando Lima is there. He is the editor-at-large of Zitmar News, and he explained just how Mozambique got to the point where thousands of people have been out on the streets, stoning cars, burning tires, and looting shops.
First of all, there is evidence, not in these elections, but past elections, that fraud have been a norm in election time. Last year, Mr. Venancio Mondlane was contesting the city of Maputo, the capital of Mozambique. And once again, parallel counting, parallel tabulation had shown that there were gross figures altered both in Maputo and Matola city nearby, where the results have been grossly tempered. Plus, a number of respected bodies also came to public saying elections were marred by gross violations and irregularities, like, for example, European Union observer mission. Podemos believe that the fraud was massive, and they have the documents that can prove that the results have been significantly changed when they start counting the votes on October the 9th.
And I believe that today they have been delivering documents to prove their case at the Constitutional Court. Tell us a little bit very quickly about what their strategy is going forward.
Along with the street demonstrations, Podemos is also being very effective contesting results and fraud. Yesterday, Sunday, they delivered to the Constitutional Council, which functions as a constitutional and election court, 300 kilos of documents, basically result sheets and minutes from the election results, plus an appeal to the council trying to prove that elections were marred by fraud.
Frelimo, though, is still the biggest party, right?
Definitely, Frelimo is a big party. Despite this year, a lot of people move away from Frelimo. The official results are showing such a huge crowd voting for Frelimo. There are serious doubts if those results are for real. Also, you should have in mind that these elections as the most significant abstention from people that stay away from elections. Just 43% of the registered voters had placed their vote on October the 9th. But there is also another problem there, because even during the registration phase, there were a lot of irregularities. And so the 17 million people register, a lot of people believe that this number is not the real number of voters. The real number should be around 15 million people.
So they're essentially saying that 2 million people have been added to the voters' roll. Why would they say that?
Well, because the registration number do not meet what are the projections by our National Institute of Statistics on demographic growth. And usually our Statistics Institute is a very respected institution. And so people believe that those figures have been largely inflated.
What's the next step for the opposition, for Mr. Mondlane and Podemos?
This Monday, Mr. Venancio Mondlane is announcing new initiatives in order to claim the results of the elections, namely that he won the elections. Clearly, the social and economic situation of the country, it will get worse if those demonstrations will continue in the streets. Now we have attacks on police stations. We have attacks on Frelimo headquarters. So the level of violence and selected violence is increasing across the country.
That's Fernando Lima, editor-at-large of Zitmar News in Mozambique. French President Emmanuel Macron is in Morocco for a fence-mending state visit. Relations between Rabat and Paris had been, shall we say, frosty for a few years. The two nations had been on very good terms before things went awry over the treatment, among other things, of Moroccans wanting to visit France and the sticky issue of recognition of a sparsely populated desert region on the northwest coast of the continent. Also, France had been trying to beef up its relationship with Morocco's neighbour, Algeria. And that is something Rabat doesn't like, because Algiers supports a Sahrawi claim for independence. The Moroccans call it Western Sahara. The African Union recognises it as a full country called the Sahrawi Arab Democratic Republic. Morocco annexed the territory in 1975 and has refused to relinquish control over it. Since then, it's been the subject of a long-running territorial dispute between Morocco and the indigenous Sahrawi people, led by the Polisario Front. Only three countries, the US, Israel, and Spain, have formally recognized Morocco's claim. Now, Paris is prepared to recognize Rabat's plan for the territory. There's a lot to unpack, so let's get to it with Ricardo Fabiani, Project Director for North Africa at the International Crisis Group. Did President Macron's visit to Morocco come as a surprise?
No, definitely not a surprise. I would say it was expected after the announcement that Macron made in late July, when he said that France was recognizing Moroccan sovereignty over Western Sahara, and most importantly, was considered the Moroccan autonomy plan for the territory of Western Sahara. as the best solution to that conflict. That was a bit of a, if you like, a turning point in the bilateral relationship between the two countries after several months of, let's say, relative chilliness between the two.
What brought on the chilliness? Was it the Sahrawi Republic or were there other things?
So the main issue was Western Sahara, right? So Morocco sees its relationship with France mostly through that sort of filter. And it was annoyed that for several years, France refused to change its position of support for the autonomy plan, but indicating that its support for this autonomy plan was just one of the options on the table and not the best option to solve the conflict. There were also other issues. There were accusations made by French officials regarding the use of a spyware by the Moroccans on some members of the French government. All of these issues contributed.
France and Morocco had tensions as well around the number of visas that France was granting to Moroccans. Why was that the case? This was happening in 2021.
The problem was that, yes, of course, France started to implement this policy of reducing the number of visas, not just for Morocco, by the way, but also for other North African countries. And that was partly a response to domestic pressures on regarding the problem of migration to the country. But the perception, particularly in Morocco, I would say more so than in other countries in the Maghreb, was that there was all of a sudden a unilateral change in this position that was not properly communicated, and that most importantly affected everyone, including people who normally would have no problems whatsoever visiting France or studying in France, would normally commute between Paris and Casablanca or Rabat. And so that, I would say, was a real reason of annoyance, if you like, between the two countries. And of course, it added, I would say, it fueled, if you want, the tensions and the misunderstandings between the two countries and created and contributed to an atmosphere of tensions between them.
What was the historic relationship between the two countries? France, of course, is the former colonial power, but colonial powers have different kinds of relationships with their former colonies. For instance, I know that the relationship between France and Algeria is much more contentious than it is between France, say, and I'm wondering, Morocco, maybe?
I think that's correct. The relationship between France and Morocco is a very close, tight one. The Moroccan authorities, right after independence, decided to continue to cultivate the existing relations with France. They did not go for a sort of sudden interruption of these relations. Of course, Morocco was a protectorate, was not annexed completely by France as was the case of Algeria. There was no settler colonialism, no major settler colonialism taking place. So there were some factors that contributed to a better relationship.
There wasn't a war of independence either, as it was
indeed,
with Algeria,
exactly.
A very vicious war.
Exactly. The point here is that the Moroccan state remained in place. And after independence, that helped, all of these factors helped with cultivating a very close relationship between the two countries, to the point where the Moroccans see this relationship with France almost as a special relationship. And the French usually tend to reciprocate this perception, which is also why the Moroccans really expected a lot more from the French a lot earlier on Western Sahara.
So President Macron will be in Morocco for 3 days. What else is on the agenda in the broadest terms?
So in return, if you like, for the position that France has taken on this issue and the upgrade in the bilateral relationship, now there is an expectation in France in particular that Morocco will be generous in some of the other issues that are at stake between the two countries. One of them, of course, is the issue of migration. And there is always the idea that having positive, good relations with a North African state means that policies such as the expulsion of migrants and returning migrants to Morocco, for example, should be smoother and easier in the future. But there's also a lot of business deals that are at stake here, particularly regarding the sale of aircrafts by Airbus. And Airbus obviously being an important company that in which France has considerable interests. And of course, the other big business deal has to do with the railways. the fact that Morocco is expanding significantly, its national railway, and particularly its high-speed lines, and France through Alstom is hoping to clinch some deals, therefore some sales of some of its high-speed trains. So there are considerable, I would say, business interests in particular that play an important role in the consolidation and improvement of this bilateral relationship.
That's Ricardo Fabiani, Project Director for North Africa at the International Crisis Group. This is Focus on Africa from the BBC World Service. We've just been talking about a country France has historical ties to and how those ties had become frayed and are now being restored by President Macron's visit to Morocco. But what is life like for people from those countries in Africa when they move to France? Millions of them would have moved as a result of colonization throughout the 19th and 20th century. Many of them would have been born in France. The second, third, fourth, and further generations of people who had come from countries like Algeria, Tunisia, Senegal, Cameroon, Guinea, Mali, encouraged by France to think of themselves as French. In fact, French West Africa, as it was called, comprised 8 countries. Other colonies included Madagascar and Mauritius in the south and parts of Somalia and Sudan. And I bet you didn't know that. But now, more and more young people with parental or familial ties in West Africa are leaving France in a sort of reverse exodus back to the land of their forebears. My colleague Noor Abida has a personal interest in this story, and she explored it for BBC Africa Eye, available on our YouTube channel and also in discussion here and now on radio and in the podcast with me. Take a listen.
The idea actually came from my producer, Natalie, and so we both have experience. We grew up in France, and we really wanted to explore the reason why some young people choose to leave France to go to Africa in order to set up their own businesses, to reconnect with their roots, and also sometimes because of the discrimination that they have experienced in France. And all of these things are things that I was able to relate to because it's something that I grew up in France also. And I also left when I was younger, so that was something I was really interested in. You know, I wanted to know, because I left almost 10 years ago, more than a decade ago, and I wanted to know, you know, like 12 years later, are things still the same or are things changing? I really wanted to understand, you know, why do some people choose to leave behind their family, their friends, you know, the place they were born, to go to somewhere else that they may not always be familiar with?
Because in this particular instance, we're talking about people who have parental and familial ties with various African countries, but they're leaving France to go back to countries that are not necessarily the countries where their ties are. Some of the people that you spoke to went to Senegal.
Yes.
Why did they choose Senegal?
Some of them like had some roots there, and some of them, you know, were passionate about the country and had been there. So, for example, one person that we spoke to was Menka, and the reason why he wanted to go to Senegal is because for him, he thought that he was able to find things that he wasn't necessarily going to be able to find in France. So we spoke to him, and this is what he said.
En France, on peut avoir l'impression d'avoir un plafond.
In France, sometimes it feels like there's a glass ceiling. Within the leadership, the managers, you find very little diversity, very, very little, if any at all. Obviously, Africa feels more like open arms to me.
That's Menka. Is Menka from Senegal or is he from another country?
Yeah, from Senegal.
Right, so he was going back to somewhere where he had a direct link to. Now, the film covers varied motivations for returning to Senegal. Can you share some of these perspectives and what they reveal about what people feel about identity and belonging?
Something that was very interesting in the documentary is that the situation is actually quite complicated. It's quite nuanced, you know. A lot of the people that we spoke to, they do want to leave, but they feel really attached to France. One of the person that we spoke to, so he is the brother of Fatoumata, one of the characters that's in the film. And even though they're from the same family, they have some very different opinions about what's happening. And so he was talking about her sister. And this is Abdul, and this is what he said.
I'm worried about her. I hope she'll be fine. I hope she'll do okay. But I don't feel the need to reconnect with anything. My culture and my family is here. Africa is the continent of our ancestors, but it's not really ours because we weren't there.
So Abdul is worried about his sister.
and he doesn't feel that sense of belonging to the continent. How did you choose the people that you would interview? Because they come from different backgrounds. And how did that shape the film?
We really wanted to represent a very broad idea of what it means to be French. And this is why we picked so many people from different backgrounds. So one of the women that we spoke to is called Audrey. She's a teacher.
Like me, like not you. A teacher.
Another one is Fatoumata. She's a businesswoman. We also have Menka, who's on the brink of, you know, setting up his own business. And he's at the moment, he's working on a dating app. You know, they're coming from different places in France, you know. And some of them are Muslims, some of them are not. So we just really wanted to show, you know, because sometimes I feel like, you know, if you think about the French people, what is the French, the thing that come to mind? I don't know. Is it somebody like with a beret and a baguette? But no, you know, like being French can be so, like, very different. Like, for example, for me, I'm often asked when I meet people, oh, where are you from? And they just, oh, and when I say I'm French, like, oh, really? You don't look like a French person. But what does that mean? What does a French person look like?
You know? I must say that for me, as somebody from South Africa, and I know that people who come from other parts of Africa, they find it very odd when Black people with familial roots in African countries say they're French. Mm-hmm. That, of course, that was part of the French ideology when they were colonizers, right? So I'm interested in seeing the film and the intergenerational conversations that people had. Is that something that the younger generation embraces more fully and the older generations don't? Tell me about that.
I think that was so interesting about the film. So, for example, one of the cases that we have, so we have Menka and his mother. What was interesting is that, you know, his mother made the move from Senegal. She came to France when she was a baby. So that was something that we're exploring, you know, in this, and how in certain families, they can have completely different opinion. There's a moment in the documentary, like you would have to watch it, where I was actually invited to a dinner for iftar, and actually they cooked tibujen for me, and it was the first time I was trying it, you know.
Tibujen is the legendary rice dish from Senegal. It is the most delicious rice dish. Jollof wars can go. Tibujen wins hands down.
It was amazing. And the funny thing, I've always wanted to, you know, to try one, but, you know, every time something happened, and like that was the perfect occasion. And so while we were having the tibujen and eating, I asked them the question about laïcité, you know, and then they told me...
Explain what is laïcité.
The laws, which date back to the 19th century, were designed to curb the influence of the Catholic Church and enforce what is known as laïcité or French secularism. And the principles rest on the separation of church and state and equality before the law.
That's Noor Abida and BBC Africa Eye. Focus on Africa was put together by Victor Silva, Yvette Twagira-Maria, and as ever, Charles Kitonga brought it from Nairobi. Sunita Nahar was the senior journalist. Johnny Hall was our technical producer. Andre Lombard and Alice Mudengi are our editors. I'm Audrey Brown, and we'll talk again next time.